The Pacific Ocean is the largest body of water ever known to man. At nearly 10,000 miles or 15,000 kilometers long at its widest point, one could actually drill a hole all the way through the center of the Earth off the coast of Peru and end up in the Gulf of Thailand or Gulf of Tonkin, bizarrely enough, both in the same massive ocean covering nearly one-third of the planet's entire surface. For comparison, 14% larger than the entire surface area of the planet Mars. However, as barren as the Pacific Ocean seemingly is, there are thousands of islands, atolls, reefs, and land formations scattered throughout this dramatic feat of nature, and these landmasses famously have some of the most unique and confounding life forms on the surface of the Earth due to their isolation, and perhaps the same could even be said for the people who live there today in terms of their culture and genetics. Here in the United States, we often use the terms Pacific Islands or South Pacific to describe this collection of islands in this region that can't really be roped in with any specific continent, although I prefer to use the term Oceania to refer to this region. We also use the terms Pacific Islander or sometimes simply Islander to describe their native inhabitants from a cultural or racial aspect, but as many have pointed out, just like the phrase Latin American, this is more of a geographic description rather than a racial or genetic one, as there are massive differences in so-called Pacific Islanders. The exact parameters of just what exactly constitutes Oceania is fuzzy, as most regional geographic descriptors are, but generally speaking, this includes the collection of outer islands in the Pacific Ocean stretching from Hawaii, New Zealand, Guam, to Easter Island, Australia, and the smaller island of Tasmania, the island of New Guinea or Papua, and perhaps a few of the islands in the eastern Maluku or Moluccas Islands. The story of human habitation in this far-flung region of the world actually stretches back many hundreds of thousands of years, but not the humans you're thinking of, as some of the earliest hominid remains to be discovered in the Southeast Asia Oceania region are that of Homo floresiensis, the infamously short people who lived in what is now modern-day Indonesia. But the Denisovans were actually the people group most closely related to modern Homo sapiens who inhabited this land. When the first group of humans migrated through southern Eurasia, they very quickly wiped out both groups of people some 45 to 60,000 years ago, but not before extensive interbreeding with the Denisovans, although Homo floresiensis was actually too genetically disparate to breed with Homo sapiens, but I'm sure they did try. Tens of thousands of years ago, when the Earth was much cooler, more water was stored in the polar ice caps and other massive glaciers around the world, hence lowering sea levels and exposing large amounts of land, especially in the Malay Archipelago of Southeast Asia and the Pacific Islands, with most of Southeast Asia being connected in a giant landmass known as Sundaland, and New Guinea, Australia, and Tasmania being one land known as Sahul. Therefore, it was likely a much easier journey for ancient humans to travel from Eurasia into Oceania in the past than it would be in more recent times, with rising sea levels cutting these lands into smaller islands, which is why the Oceanian gene pool was so isolated from the rest of humanity for so many tens of thousands of years. In fact, among non-African descendants, indigenous Oceanians have one of the most untouched genomes, also being the most genetically disparate from sub-Saharan Africans, despite a seeming overlap in appearance of the two groups. The people who remained in Sahul, or New Guinea and Australia, would become the modern Papuan and Australian Aboriginal tribes we see today, while those who remained in Sundaland would slowly be encroached upon by migrants from East Asia to the north, being driven into the mountains of various islands throughout Southeast Asia, and when first encountered by Spanish explorers, were coined the Negrito, or little black people, due to their small stature and darker skin when compared to other Southeast Asians. Negrito peoples include a scant handful of peoples in the Philippines, Peninsular Malaysia, and even Thailand, and it's rather incredible to think that before the migration of East Asian groups, these people were actually the original inhabitants of all of Southeast Asia, even the mainland, and modern Southeast Asians show varying levels of admixture from this original people, which explains the difference in appearance and complexion with East and Northeast Asians like the Chinese or Koreans. By the way, if you've ever seen the 2004 remake of King Kong by Peter Jackson, considering the movie takes place in an isolated island in Southeast Asia, those terrifying natives of Skull Island are presumably based off the real-life Negrito tribes, especially the Andamanese, with the inhabitants of North Sentinel Island being an extremely aggressive and primitive people. What's quite fascinating, though, is when we look at the natives of the outer Pacific islands, such as the more remote New Zealand or Tahiti or Hawaii, with these groups not exactly lining up with people groups like the Papuans or Aboriginals, and this is because they actually only share a minority of their ancestry with them. When spreading out from Taiwan and Southeast Asia thousands of years ago, the Proto-Austronesian migrants were able to do what no other East Asians had done before in history, that is, pushing eastwards into Oceania. But rather than settling on the island of New Guinea, the Austronesians mostly passed by this island, intermixing with the natives here and there, but retaining the majority of their East Asian DNA, but we'll get to the specifics soon. The vast majority of Negrito communities, similar to the Pacific Islanders, do have some degree of Eastern Eurasian genetic admixture due to their geographic proximity and the thousands of years of intermixing, with most Negrito peoples in the Philippines and Malaysia only being around 20 to maybe 60% Australoid or Oceanian in origin at the very highest. However, the Andamanese, who have remained isolated on the Andaman Islands for literally tens of thousands of years, do not show the same levels of Eurasian admixture, in fact showing no recent Eurasian admixture whatsoever, being one of the most pure genomes of any people on the planet, showing some affinity to other indigenous people of Southeast Asia, Papua New Guinea, Aboriginal Australians, as well as the Adivasi tribals of South Central India. As I discussed in a previous video over the Australoid or Vadoid extended regionalized ancestral continuum, what I refer to as Southern Eurasian, the lesser degree of Western and Eastern Eurasian admixture in an individual's genome in South Asia, the closer they lean towards the Oceanian / Pacific Islander cluster, which you wouldn't really expect considering their distance from one another, but it would appear that there was previously both a genetic and geographic continuum between ancient indigenous South Asian hunter-gatherers and Australian Aborigines, but the migration of other Eurasians broke this connection. The Austronesians who settled throughout the Pacific eventually evolved into three main people groups, somewhat loosely divided between the regions of Melanesia, Micronesia, and Polynesia, with the Austronesian-speaking Melanesians, such as those in the Solomon Islands or Vanuatu, only having around 10 to 25% East Asian DNA, Polynesians having around 60 to 80% East Asian DNA, and Micronesians actually having less East Asian DNA than that, despite being closer to Asia, at around 40 to 60%. Hence, there's a very large degree of overlap between Polynesians and Micronesians, with both groups on average sharing around 60 to 80% of the same ancestry from the past few thousand years, and possibly even more, while these two only share around 10 to 40% of ancestry with Melanesians, although there is a huge variance due to the diversity of Melanesian people groups. So there's a strong genetic continuum or overlap between Micronesians and Polynesians, but not with Melanesians or Papuans, so it doesn't exactly make sense to simply put them all under the same racial banner of Pacific Islander, since keep in mind, most indigenous Papuans have virtually no East Asian admixture whatsoever. However, this isn't the only group we do this with. As in the Horn of Africa and Sudan, the people are essentially a mix of Nilotic and Middle Eastern DNA, and yet we just consider them to be African. And many in northern India and Pakistan may have more Middle Eastern DNA than indigenous South Asian. So it's very difficult to know when to draw the line, and it shows how cultural aspects have such a huge impact on our perception of these classifications. The Pacific Islands are also known for their extreme linguistic diversity as well, especially among Papuan, Melanesian, and Aboriginal people, with there being over 800 distinct languages native to New Guinea and 250 in Australia. And some of these languages are so different from one another that they've yet to be classified in any major family, and honestly, it's unknown if they ever will be, considering their genealogical origins may be lost forever due to the extensive history of human habitation in the region, as most language families can only be traced back a few thousand years before linguists are stumped on their nexus. The westernmost Papuan-speaking people are actually found in the country of East Timor, although all people from eastern Indonesia or the Moluccas and Timor have some Papuan admixture. The region is also a bit of a mess politically speaking, with the western half of New Guinea being administered by Indonesia, which has seen a strong backlash by some Papuan nationalists and independence advocates, and there are also many islands that are administered by Europeans, such as the French in Tahiti and New Caledonia, or Americans, such as in Guam and Hawaii. However, most islands have since gained independence. Western Eurasian DNA, mainly European in origin, is prevalent throughout many Pacific Islander communities, especially Micronesia and Polynesia. And on many islands, there is actually no such thing as a pure-blooded Polynesian anymore, since virtually the entire population has some degree of European ancestry in their pedigree, most famously in New Zealand, with the entire Maori community of hundreds of thousands of individuals having varying levels of European blood, sometimes being minor and other times being quite significant. In other islands, Pacific Islanders may have ancestry from centuries of German, Spanish, American, British, or most recently, Japanese occupation. And interestingly, the only major Native American and African DNA that can be observed in Oceania outside of recent migrants is among the Rapa Nui people of Easter Island. And this is entirely due to the migration of mixed-race Latinos from Chile arriving on the island and intermixing with the community in generations past, once the native people were on the brink of extinction. Various islands have different terms that they use for mixed-race people. Quite ironic, considering that most islanders themselves are technically mixed-race. But one of the most common terms is Hapa, that has been coined in Hawaii, with the multiracial community in Hawaii being the largest in the United States at nearly a quarter of the population, with the larger proportion being those who have European, Pacific Islander, and Asian ancestry, creating a new melting pot of sorts in the islands. Out of all the major races of the world, if you were to call them that, Pacific Islanders are still definitely one of the smallest, as even when including those of partial Oceanian descent, there are only around 26 million people who could be considered Pacific Islander, about 0.3% of the Earth's population, with the largest diaspora populations by far being in the mainland United States, with there actually being more Pacific Islander Americans in the continental US than in their own Pacific territories. But at the end of the day, due to intermixing, it's become increasingly difficult to say just who is a Pacific Islander anymore, with the extreme diversity in appearance, genetics, language, and culture. So go ahead and let me know your thoughts on this people group, and for today's poll, let me know which group of Pacific Islanders you'd like to learn more about. And as always, thanks for watching, everyone. This has been Mason, and I'll see you next time.